Professor Saxena, Professor Rai, Professor Anirban Pathak, Dr. Papia Choudhury, Professor Joshi, Professor Parthiv Bose, Professor Narayan Banerjee. I'm indeed extremely happy that JIIT has taken the initiative of celebrating Professor Meghnad Saha's 125th birthday, and I feel deeply honored to give this inaugural talk. I will be brief because we are slightly late, and it is really indeed a great pleasure and privilege to have the opportunity to listen to Dr. Sangamitra Roy for her very wise comments, which are of importance not only to the students, but also to older people like ourselves. That we have to work, whatever we do, we have to think of the country also. That is the message that she very nicely gave. So I'm going to do a little hurriedly, do a little bit of history, and then I will come to Professor Saha. In the 5th century, Aryabhatta, who was a great mathematician and astronomer, propounded that the planets rotate on their axis, causing day and night, and follow elliptical orbits. He also explained the causes of the solar and lunar eclipses. The Iron Pillar in Delhi, built in the 5th century, appears to have been protected from rust by the application of a thin coating of manganese dioxide. So therefore, the thin film technology, deposition technology, existed 1500 years back in India. What I tried to tell you through these two examples was that about 1000 years back or 1500 years back, the entire belt from China to India to Middle East was very advanced in science and technology. In fact, the first book on optics was written by a person from Mesopotamia, which is now in Iraq, by the name of Al-Hazar. And in fact, 2 years back, in 2015, 3 years back, we celebrated 1,000 years of that book. So what I want to tell you from these examples is the fact that we were very rich in science, technology, and mathematics. And I can give you many examples of that. One such great example is the Nalanda University, which was founded in the 5th century, and Jeffrey Garton in New York Times writes that it was one of the first great universities in recorded history. The university was an architectural and environmental masterpiece. At its peak, it had 10,000 students and attracted scholars from Korea, Japan, China, Persia. The university died a slow death about the time that some of the great European universities, including those in Oxford, were just getting started. So it was before Oxford, and of course, at that time, America did not exist. And it was burnt down in the year 1197. And that started the relatively dark period in the development of mathematics and science in India. The schools of learning were converted to madrasas, and the Hindu gurukuls also converted to influence of orthodox Vedantism. So that the religion started playing more and more important role in our lives. And development of science and technology did not take place. This was also the dark period in Europe. For example, on 17th February 1600, Bruno was burned to death by the church because he believed that the earth went round the sun and not the other way round. But then came the Renaissance, and with the work of Galileo, who was also imprisoned, but he sort of retracted his statement that no, the earth does not go around the sun, the sun goes around the earth, and therefore his life was saved. So such was the influence of the church over science and technology. Galileo is often called as the father of modern physics. And then came Isaac Newton, who made revolutionary contributions to science. And this was in the 17th century. The laws of planetary motion, calculus, a book on optics, and these were the great contributions that Isaac Newton made. Then came, after Newton and Galileo, came the Industrial Revolution, which started around 1760 and involved, for example, going from hand production methods to machines. The steam engine, the spinning machine, etc., started around the middle of the 18th century. However, that Industrial Revolution did not take place in India. It was only on 20th January 1817, about 200 years back, the Hindu College in Calcutta was formally opened with 20 scholars. This was the first institution of higher learning in the modern sense in Asia. The foundation committee of the college was headed by Raja Ramohan Rai, who along with six others donated their personal wealth to establish the college. In 1855, it was renamed as Presidency College, and on 20th July 2010, it became Presidency University. The pioneering discoveries of Jagdish Chandra Bose in physics and plant physiology and of Prafulla Chandra Ray in industrial chemistry, as was mentioned earlier, both were teachers of Professor Meghnad Saha and Satyendranath Bose. So these were the great experiments that were carried out in pre-independent India in Presidency College. And then in 1857, three universities were set up. I thought I would just mention these dates for the younger generation, that to know of our history as to how these universities came about. And three universities were set up in Madras, Calcutta, and Bombay, similar to the structure of the University of London. Professor Meghnad Saha was born on October 6, 1893, in a small village near Dhaka, which is now in Bangladesh. His parents were very poor and belonged to a backward class. Thus, he could not afford to go to a good school. However, he did win merit scholarships and eventually joined Presidency College for the BSc degree in 1911. And as has been mentioned, his classmate was Satyendranath Bose. In 1916, both Saha and S.N. Bose were appointed lecturers in the Department of Applied Mathematics in the University College of Science. However, they soon got themselves transferred to the Physics Department, where a year later, C.V. Raman joined as Palit Professor of Physics. So you can imagine the structure of Calcutta universities at that time. And it was the vision of Ashutosh Mukherjee that he had C.V. Raman, Meghnad Saha, and Professor Satyendranath Bose all together, and Shishir Mitra, and all of them were there in Calcutta University. It was the Harvard of the East. It was actually better than Harvard at that time. Professor Saha submitted his thesis, his doctoral thesis in 1918, based on the work that he had done himself, without much guidance from anyone, and was awarded the DSc degree by Calcutta University in 1919. In 1919 itself, only 3 years after the very famous paper by Einstein on general theory of relativity, Professor Saha and Professor Bose translated the papers of Einstein and Minkowski. And this was the first book on general relativity that was published from University of Calcutta in 1920. This was a landmark achievement. And imagine the department, the general theory of relativity, which is itself a very difficult subject, and we have a great expert, Professor Panchaprakashan is a great expert on general theory of relativity. So for the young students who want to know a little bit more on general theory of relativity, you can ask your questions to Professor Panchaprakashan. So here they started teaching general theory of relativity to the MSc students. Imagine the strength of the department at that time. At that time also, about which we will hear from Professor Joshi, that he derived the, shortly after his PhD, he derived the famous ionization equation, which made him world famous almost instantaneously. And in 1919, the Premchand Raichand Scholarship of the Calcutta University was awarded to Meghnad Saha, which enabled him to spend about 2 years in Europe. He first went to London, where he spent about 5 months in the laboratory of Dr. Fowler. From London, he moved to Berlin, where he worked in the laboratory of Professor Nernst. He later got the Nobel Prize for his contribution to thermodynamics. And this is a photograph of Professor Saha in Berlin in 1921. And this is the farewell party of Professor Saha just before his departure to United Kingdom. This is Professor Saha, this is Professor Raman, and this is Professor Satyendranath Bose. And then after reaching London, he gave a more profound theory for the ionization equation, about which we will hear from Professor Saha, and which was communicated to the Royal Society by Professor Fowler. In November 21, Professor Saha returned to India and joined the University of Calcutta as Khara Professor of Physics. Now, you must remember, in the year 1921, he was just 28 years old. And he had not been the fellow of the Royal Society, and Sir Ashutosh Mukherjee once again had the vision and the wisdom to appoint him as a professor. So that is the identifying the right people and giving them the position, which has become so difficult today in our present scenario. However, he moved to Allahabad in 1923 as head of the physics department. Now, I cannot confirm, the professorship at Allahabad was advertised, and the opinion of people like Einstein and Dirac were sought, and they both recommended the name of Professor Saha. In parallel, I will digress here for a moment. Around that period of time, Professor Satyendranath Bose, on 4th June 1924, this is the original letter about which we will hear more from Professor Parthabho. Satyendranath Bose wrote this letter to Einstein, enclosing a manuscript which led to what is now known as Bose-Einstein statistics. When he received the manuscript, what Bose did was that he asked Einstein to translate that manuscript to German and publish it in Zeitschrift für Physik. And Professor Einstein immediately recognized the worth of that paper. And within 1 month, this is dated 3rd July 1924, this is the handwritten manuscript of Einstein. He translated it himself, and there was no laptop or nothing. And this is the first page of the translated manuscript in German, and which made him very famous. In 1927, while at Allahabad University, Professor Saha was elected as Fellow of the Royal Society of London, and this is a photograph of the celebration that was carried out in the, on the background is the Allahabad University. And in 1929, as Dr. Neeraj Kumar mentioned, Professor Saha, along with other colleagues, established the first science academy in India at Allahabad, of which Professor Saha himself was the founder president. And Dr. Neeraj Kumar mentioned that Professor Saha wrote, an academy of science can do a great deal. This particular workshop is supported, of course, by JIIT and the Delhi chapter of NASI. What is the purpose of this academy? The Academy of Science can do a great deal by educating public opinion, undertaking particular problems, and bringing out scientific workers in various fields for discussion and cooperative research. But the main function of the academy should be towards cultural improvement by contributions to human knowledge. And then at Allahabad, he wrote the famous book on heat. And this became so famous internationally. And we studied in our undergraduate course, and when we did our BSc and MSc, and even today, if I have a difficulty in understanding a concept in thermodynamics, I always go back to the famous Saha Srivastava treatise. At around that time, my father was doing his DSc. He did his undergraduate and MSc at Allahabad University. He was in chemistry, but he used to work with Professor Saha. And this is a testimonial that Professor Saha wrote about my father. And in this portion, I want to read out this particular part. The thesis that Mr. Ghatak, that is my father, submitted in April 1934 for the DSc degree of Allahabad University was highly spoken of by Professor Richard Willstatter, Nobel laureate, the greatest of the living organic chemists, who was one of his examiners. What I want to point out here is that during that time, it was pre-independent India. Allahabad University did not have much money, but they made sure that for the DSc degree, the thesis went to a Nobel laureate. Such was the standard that was set up by people like Professor Saha and Professor Neelratan Dhar and his other colleagues. And I am very, very, very proud of this letter. I have kept it safely. And so this was the standard that we all should try to learn and create, that we have to have our students, our faculty, achieve their highest potential, and so that their thesis can be examined by a person of Nobel Prize winning status. This is a photograph of Professor Meghnad Saha and Professor Homi Bhabha, Dr. Homi Bhabha, amongst people like Pauli, Heisenberg, and Max Born, Lise Meitner, who discovered fission, and Stern, and this is Dirac. After nearly 15 years at University of Allahabad, Professor Saha came back to University of Calcutta as Pali Professor of Physics in July 1938. And At that time, the fission process was discovered. The neutron will get absorbed by the uranium 235 nucleus and will split into two very tightly bound nucleus, releasing an enormous amount of energy and also releasing some of a few neutrons. And the neutrons emitted in a fission process can lead to a chain reaction, leading to release of an enormous amount of energy. So the field of nuclear physics became extremely important around 1938. And Professor Saha, that was his vision, realized the importance of the discovery and of the need to study nuclear physics in India. He immediately persuaded the university authorities to include nuclear physics in the curriculum. He set up, he founded the Institute of Nuclear Physics. A man, so what I'm trying to point out is the vision of this person. Institute of Nuclear Physics was formally inaugurated by Nobel laureate Irene Joliot Curie on 11 January 1950. After Professor Saha's death in 1956, the institute was named as Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics. And this is one of the greatest contributions of Professor Saha to the country at large. And this is a photograph of Dr. Bidinath Choudhury and Professor Saha in front of the cyclotron at the Institute of Nuclear Physics. I'll digress here for a moment, and I will mention that in 1869, in an article entitled On the Desirability of a National Institution for the Cultivation of Sciences by the Natives of India, the great visionary and philanthropist Dr. Mahendralal Sarkar wrote that the prevailing backwardness of the country was due to backwardness of science. And this is true even today. Today, 50% of our population, which is more than 400 million people, are still below the poverty line. And that is because of the absence of the development of science and technology in our country. I'm 100% sure of this. And that is what predicted by Mahendralal Sarkar in 1869. And that the solution was the vigorous pursuit of sciences by original research. And therefore, on 29 July 1876, he founded the Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science, IACS, at Bobada Street, Calcutta, supported not by the government, but by generous public contributions. And as most of you will know, it is at this institute that C.V. Raman carried out his famous work, which led to getting him the Nobel Prize. And in 1946, IACS embarked upon a new development plan under the dynamic leadership of Dr. Meghnath Saha, who prepared a master plan of the Jadavpur campus of IACS and was also the director. So he completely planned out the institute, which is now one of the most premier institutes in our country. What I have tried to tell you in the last few slides are the great leadership qualities of Professor Meghnath Saha. Of course, in addition to the outstanding work which led to the Saha ionization equation, read this carefully. In addition to the outstanding work which led to the Saha ionization equation, which should have given him the Nobel Prize, many people feel, he made Allahabad University a world-class university. He established the first science academy. He created the Institute of Nuclear Physics and made the Indian Association for Cultivation of Science a world-class research organization. I would like to mention that today, many people ask me, when will we have a person like C.V. Raman who will get the Nobel Prize? And my answer to them is that whereas it will be good to have a person winning the Nobel Prize, but winning the Nobel Prize is an individual recognition. It is something like the Bhatnagar Award. It helps the individual who receives that. But what is required today in our country is creation of institution and motivating the younger generation, which are large in number and very bright in quality, to motivate them for further. And this is what people like. So people like Professor Saha, Professor Dr. Homi Bhabha, or Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, Dr. Abdul Kalam, they did. So if I have to put the contribution of the scientists, I will put these four or five scientists above C.V. Raman. C.V. Raman, of course, did outstanding work in spectroscopy, which brought him the Nobel Prize, but it was an individualistic effort. But what Saha created, people like Saha and Bhabha created, were institutions. And it is this kind of vision and leadership that is more required in India. Once you have that leader, these are the young, bright minds will come forward, and we have the, we are in our country, we are blessed with outstanding brains that will grow automatically. So our main motivation, the older generation has the responsibility of creating an atmosphere which people like Sir Ashutosh Mukherjee, Meghnath Saha, and other people try to create, to provide an environment where the younger generation will come up. So I will conclude by a slide in which I will show Jawaharlal Nehru with Einstein. This was just after independence, and he was a great admirer of Einstein, and he went to Princeton and met him. And the first question that Einstein asked was, how is Bose? And the story goes like this. He thought he was thinking of Subhash Chandra Bose. then he got rectified, and he said, but the greatness of Nehru was that as soon as he came back, he made Professor Satyendranath Bose the national professor. Thank you for your attention.